you here on this launch to give you the information that you need, from business to economy to politics to technology. And that's all we do here on this launch, from the beginning to the end.
Thank you for joining us on the program today. The program is New Sponge, coming to you live from Ben Television. My name is Tunde Alabi. On the show this evening, we are in Nigeria. We're taking a look at Nigeria's economy and, of course, the issues around the loan that the government has decided, about $30 billion loan that the government has decided to take. And, of course, the refusal of the Senate to approve this loan. And we'll be taking a look at, will the Senate be able to maintain its standpoint on their refusal to approve the loan? Of course, the reason the Senate did return the request to the presidency was because they said the presidency did not give enough information as required by the Senate to allow them make informed decision. And of course, the presidency has said they will not get into any argument with the Senate. All they will do is provide the Senate with more information. So on the program today, we are looking at the loan request by the presidency and, of course, Nigeria's debt profile. Let me just quickly tell you that the Director General of the Debt Management Office for Nigeria, Abraham Nwankwo, few months ago did say that Nigeria's debt currently stands at about $64.4 billion. In naira terms, the debt office said that Nigeria's debt increased by nearly 4 trillion naira, and that the debt profile rose from 12.6 trillion at the end of 2015 to 16.3 trillion naira as of June 30, 2016. And they said that Nigeria's external debt stood at 3.19 trillion naira as of June, while domestic debt stood at 10.61 trillion naira. But in all, they have valued Nigeria's debt profile at 64.4 billion naira. And as of that time, the fear of so many people is that Nigeria's current debt profile will be affecting the economy, and that its impact on naira, its impact on the economy, the cost of goods, the cost of living will be massive and excessive. That was before the federal government did decide to borrow more money. But now the government has said it's going to be borrowing more money as it stands. That's about $30 billion to be borrowed. What will be the impact of borrowing more money from wherever the government is going to borrow the money from? What will be the impact on Nigeria's economy? Is the government borrowing from the IMF, the World Bank? Where is it borrowing from? Of course, the government is taking the money from an international organization. And these are the issues we'll be taking a look at on the program today. Would the loan being sought by the federal government of Nigeria have positive or negative impact on Nigeria's economy as it stands? My guest in the studio by my immediate left is Mr. Chukwudi Nwabukwo, the chairman of the Association of Nigerian Journalists in the UK. Chukwudi, thank you for joining us on the program today.
Thank you.
Also joining us on the program today is a former member of the House of Representatives in Nigeria between 2003 and 2011, former gubernatorial aspirant in Ogun State in 2015. Joining us on the program today, Honorable Kaode Amusan. Honorable, thank you for joining us on the program today. My pleasure. You're welcome. Honorable, let me start with you. You were in government, the legislative, at some point. The issue of borrowing money to fund the budget, when you were in government, how did you see it? Not even when you were in government, generally as a member of Nigeria's upper legislative arm, how did the legislative arm see the issue of borrowing money to service the budget?
Well, let me start by commending the Senate, because I read on the news this morning that the Nigerian Senate, they rejected the loan request sent by our president to them.
But there's a condition attached to the rejection.
Yeah, I agree. But it's still rejection as far as it is concerned. It's still rejection because they want him to give them the update of what he actually wanted to do with the money. And then when I read the whole, you know, documentary about what actually they wanted to do with the money, I realized they wanted to, you know, most of this funding are going to infrastructure, healthcare services, agriculture, employment, and so on and so forth. And I sit back and ask myself, do we actually needed all this again?
What do you mean?
Do we actually needed the money? I mean, the loan. When you are talking about infrastructure, talking about road, electricity, and the water, are you with me? And then in that area, you see, to me, all these things can go via concession, via build, operate, and transfer from the private sector. Because most of these roads we are talking about are federal roads, probably federal roads mostly, because we are talking about federal government. Roads.
Yeah.
Okay, let's take an example of Lekki-Epe access being funded by private sector. Today we have a toll gate there. And they will collect this money in the toll gate for some number of years, is that not so?
Mm-hmm.
And return it back to the government.
Mm-hmm.
Is that not what we mean by build, operate, and transfer?
Yes.
On the area of infrastructure, we can still do that. Our power has already been privatized. And I'm sure most of the companies that buy into it, one way or the other, they were trying. Are you getting me? Therefore, in that area, I don't see
any... So the question for you is, why would the government need money to fund a privatized sector?
Sector!
Or why would the government need money to fund road when it can be
concessions to private enterprises, investors. Are you getting me? That is one. In healthcare facilities, health itself, if well structured, can pay for itself. There are health insurance, whereby they will compel me, just starting from the workforce of the federal government. Are you getting me? Compel them to by law to subscribe to it, even if it is common 1,000 per person. Are you getting me? In a month, as contribution to the healthcare sector, your health insurance, which will give them a free healthcare
services
in some area, not on major. In some areas, not on major. And when you look at the workforce in Nigeria today, by the time you deduct 1,000 naira from each and every one of them and get a proper health care managers, stroke insurance, you know, to take care of that, such money can be channeled into developing our health care facilities. In that area too, I don't see any reason why we need anything loan for that. Lastly, on issue of employment generation, must government be doing business in business? For me, employment should be allowed to be operated by private sector. When they do the needful, you understand me, employment would come through the private sector services. Because the reason why is that the only employment the government can guarantee is either civil service from the ministry or what have you. Majorly, employment are given by the private sector. So I think that one too, I doubt if there is any need for loan to establish employment generation. So to me, I don't see the need. That is why I will commend the Senate for rejecting it. And most importantly, this loan will not just come ordinarily. It will come with a lot of conditionalities. IMF or World Bank, they will tell you the value of, as of where we are today, look at the exchange rate. As at the last count, when you are talking about dollar in the official market, I think it's about 380 something. While in the parallel market, we're talking about 460, 470 naira to one single dollar.
Before we go to that, let me, Chukwudi, What? When you heard that the government will be borrowing money, this government will be borrowing $30 million.
$30 billion.
Don't forget that earlier this year, we were told that the Chinese government has offered this government $6 billion loan to fund infrastructure. Earlier this year, the Chinese government gave this government $6 billion loan, which will also allow them for what they call currency swap, implying that Nigerian government will also have more in its foreign reserve, Chinese yuan, as parallel with the dollar as well. $6 billion loan to fund, according to the reports from Minister of Foreign Affairs, Mr. Geoffrey, to fund infrastructure. $6 billion already, money being taken from possible looters, another $30 billion to be taken. So when you heard about this, what were your thoughts?
Thank you so much. When I heard about it, I felt it was not necessary that we go that way again. Because as from my knowledge of Nigeria, Nigeria is a very rich country, and going for loan is not in the best interest of Nigeria and Nigerians for that matter. Because the people who will manage this loan have not shown enough fiscal discipline. In the past, we have heard about Nigeria taking many loans, several loans, you know.
I mean, you can imagine the days of Obasanjo when he took billions of dollars to fund the power sector. Sure. And at the end of the day,
In fact, in all the sectors, you can even see ministries, departments, they go for loan. They had nothing to show for it. If Nigeria was a very serious country, by now, they won't be going for loan because most of the loans they have taken before, they were tied to specific projects which are not on the ground. So invariably, this loan come, when they get the loans, in Nigerian way, it is frittered away and nothing to show for it. So if there's any way we can stop taking loans, I mean, it is in order. That is why I want to commend the Senate for doing that. But I believe that the Senate is not doing that to please the federal government, and please the federal government at the center, the executive arm of government, because of the kind of infighting between them, between the two arms, between the National Assembly and the executive. I hope it is in the national interest. I hope it's not because they are listening to something.
The stoppage, the non-approval, is conditional. That said, they needed more information. The presidency has said, we'll give you more information.
Okay, I hope they give them more information. I hope it was not based on any, because I believe that the House of Rep have.
So let me pick you on that. So while the presidency is trying to prepare more information, let us assume the Senate did this in order to get certain things from the executive. So there are likelihood that between now and then, there will be us trading.
Absolutely. Yes.
Yes.
They can give us this.
Yes. It's a pro quo. They can do the deal behind it.
Let me return to Honorable. Honorable, I mean, you were in the National Assembly.
Absolutely.
How true is it that there's always this hot trading between the legislature and the executive in order for either the presidency to get his way or for the legislature to get his way?
Normally, what is called lobbying is allowed in the parliament. Even at the foreign parliament, what is called lobbying is allowed. But it now depends on the members of the parliament to have a rethink of what people are lobbying them to do, whether it is what will benefit their constituency or not. As at when I was there, if anything like this comes up, I always consult with my constituency, should we or should we not? Are you getting me? So I believe most of the senators that are doing this thing, they are not just doing it for the fun of it, because definitely you will still go back to your people at the end of the day, either go there to ask for another re-election or something of sort. So you don't do things that will jeopardize their interest. Because this one is a serious issue.
My question is,
what's your question again?
Does the National Assembly engage in trading as in exchange?
I've never been involved in such a thing.
No, you as a person.
And it has never.
I'm talking about let me tell you, institution.
I have no. What are they trying to exchange? Can you tell me something that they want to exchange?
So, for instance, the presidency say, we need this loan.
Okay.
And the Senate or the National Assembly has an issue, ongoing issue mm-hmm. with the presidency.
Mm-hmm. Like what issue?
See, for instance, in the issue of the Senate president and the trial and the trial of Bukola Saraki on forgery of the proceedings of the National Assembly.
I doubt
if, or even other issues.
I said I doubt if it tallies with what we are saying. It's a different ballgame entirely. It's a different.
So you're telling us
are you saying that if they approve this thing and the government promised them that I'm going to forget about your trial and everything, they approve and the trial continues?
And so are you saying that the executive and the legislature don't come to a compromise on certain issues?
I don't believe in such underhand. I have never been involved. I have never been in a situation where they do such an undertaking.
I'm not even talking about you.
No, I'm telling you that...
If I may come in...
Not you as a person, as an institution.
I'm telling you...
You as an individual, you're different.
I said there is nothing like that as at when I was there. Mm. Now I cannot talk for them. But my own thinking, I'm talking from my own self, you understand
experience.
Me?
Experience.
As I, when we were there, you understand me? Nothing like that has ever come up. If you are monitoring what happened between 2003 and 2011, tell me one of your experience of such.
Between 2003 and 2011,
yes.
we had Yar'Adua and
administration,
Jonathan.
Then what happened?
2003 was also part of, Obasanjo was still there.
We knew that for 2003, the greatest level of corruption between the presidency and the National Assembly happened between the National Assembly and the presidency under Obasanjo. Of course, the National Assembly did accuse Obasanjo
of power.
The people in the 7th Assembly, they accused Obasanjo. Mm. When he started accusing them of corruption, they said, you introduced Ghana must go to the National Assembly.
Well, let me say
as
something.
As a matter of
what happens to this? What Ghana must go are you talking about? Because as at when I was there, I have never at any point in time witnessed anything like Ghana must go. I must say this with all sense of responsibility.
Really?
Yes. I have never, I can tell you this.
Maybe you are
I can walk tall anywhere to say this, that I have never witnessed anything like Ghana must go in the parliament.
Really?
I am being honest with you. Give me an instance of one.
I will give you an instance.
Go ahead.
Honorable, I remember vividly that from 2000 all to 2005 or 2006, I was a Senate reporter,
okay.
Senate correspondent,
what happened?
Senate, even while during the time of Evans and when
Kachubo,
Kalibo,
okay.
Power Sanyim.
Very good.
I was at the Senate.
Okay.
I remember vividly, at least at the House of Reps,
where
you were, remember Gala Umana Abba, the former speaker. He came up in the National Assembly and showed the whole Nigerians a pack of money that he said came from the executive.
Okay.
From executive arm of government.
Okay.
In order to bribe people to remove him from office.
Okay. Okay.
That's an instance I want to give you because.
Fantastic. Let me come back. Let me answer that question.
I want to answer the two together.
Okay.
Also, when with the issue of the total.
Okay. Hold on.
There was an accusation against
that they gave 50 million. Oh, fantastic.
Hold on.
The first question is from him during the Naba era. I want to tell you that Naba left National Assembly as the Speaker in 2003 when I was coming in. I did not witness the issue of that money coming on the table to display that the executive bribed them. Are you getting me? Number two, you are talking about the bribery that occurred during the third term saga. My dearest brother. Well, I have not seen that bribe. But I tell you why. Leave me alone. Don't bother about it. Look, some of us came to the parliament as a successful businessman before we get there. Mm. And look, I will not go to somewhere now where I'm having some substantial amount of money and go and steal something that will damage my future. You understand? Absolutely. What I'm trying to say, I represent the constituency of the Mr. President then, which is Obasanjo.
Okay.
Even if such a thing happened,
you're probably not going to be a beneficiary.
Yeah, absolutely. You got it right.
Because you're coming.
Let me now tell you the issue of this third term. Mr. President then, the former president OBJ did not tell me anything about third time. I don't know anything about it, but I know he never said anything. It was all about maybe probably body language. You understand me? I was not consulted. Are you with me? And because he did not tell me, he did not speak on the national news over it, I don't have the gut to go and ask him and say, sir, is there anything like talk time you are interested? But one thing I want to tell you is this. To me, I'm speaking for myself now, as a political scientist. Are you getting me? If Obasanjo actually wanted third term, he might likely get it. You ask me why.
Why?
Good. You see, at the formation of the bill, did you hear anything until he got to the parliament? It's an executive bill, you know that?
Yes.
But at the beginning, at the formation, did you hear any rancor about the issue of third term until he gets to the parliament? No, I'm asking you a question too.
Not likely.
Oh, very good.
Not likely.
Now, you know, third term.
That's not it.
They've had their issues before then. They are at loggerhead before then. That I can confirm to you because I was in the picture. They are at loggerhead before then. But where I'm going is this. When the bill started, the foundation of the bill, I want to tell you that most governors of the then second term governors were the promoter of third term. Because they also want to enjoy another term in office. Are you getting me?
Okay.
However, by the time the bill gets to the parliament, the governors, the vice president has been expunged away from it. Remaining only the president.
Only the president.
How do you think that bill
will fly?
Because it's still going down to the state parliamentarians. We need 2/3 of the House of Assembly in the whole state. Governors are all in charge of their state. How do you think that bill will what?
So wait.
How do you believe that bill will sail? If the man is selfish, to me, I'm not speaking for him. It's just an analysis that I thought of. If the man is selfish, the man would have carried along all those governors.
Isn't that selfishness?
No.
You as a president, you attributed third term to yourself and deleted your vice president and the governors.
But now let me tell you one thing. If he actually wanted to fly, if he actually wanted and is a selfish man, he will have allowed everybody to enjoy it. Museveni did it around that time of Uganda. He did it and he got it. Because he carried everybody along. That's what I'm saying. If he actually wanted it as a then, all he needs to do is governors and everybody, okay, all of us for third time. I can tell you that.
It will fly.
It might likely fly. Not until when the bill gets to the parliament, before the governors now rose up and say, hey, this is prison. Because if this man stay one day ahead of us, it's a problem. That was when everybody now started running helter skelter and the whole thing. You should know this.
Yeah, no. And then the role, we cannot forget the role the leadership of National Assembly played.
Played!
Let's divert. The issue that led us to this was the issue of horse trading between the National Assembly.
Well,
and
I've told you there's something called lobbying which is allowed. But lobbying that I know is not issue of coming to bribe or anything. That's why there's a special advisor on National Assembly matters between the presidency and the National Assembly.
So you're telling us,
and that is their job to come and talk to them. That look, can you do this for Mr. President? Okay, let me give you an instance. When OBJ was looking for emergency
states.
Are you getting me?
Yes.
Well, are you saying they gave us money? They called us. The party called us. You understand me? The leadership of the party. From the national headquarters, they call executive meetings and talk to us. The emergency is necessary there, and we all subscribe to it.
Honorable, you might not be a party to the issue of presidency lobbying the National Assembly financially, but are you telling us in confidence you are on an international television?
Absolutely, I'm aware
that. There's nothing like financial lobbying between the National Assembly or Federal Republic of Nigeria,
my dear brother,
and the executive.
I am talking for myself. I'm talking for myself. I have never ever, while there, had any experience to have collected anything to do anything.
But do you by chance hear?
I don't hear. No.
Okay, why did the seventh members of the seventh assembly accuse Mr. Obasanjo when he began to accuse them of conscience that look,
my dear brother,
and corruption?
Don't forget that propaganda is part of the ingredients of politics.
Let me talk to Chukwudi. You were in the National Assembly as a correspondent. Tell us more about us trading, the executive trying to lobby in the parliament and the parliament trying to lobby the executive in order to have
their way.
Well, the political hustling is not just about money.
God bless.
It's not only money.
Yes.
I can say that it's only money. For example, as we said before, they might have an issue at stake. One may say, for example, now this next president is prosecuted in the court. He may come to the table with the president and say, well, if you forget about what has happened, if you forget about what happened in this case, we give you this. However you want it.
That's rub my back, I rub your back.
Yeah, that is a compromise. That agreement, and it is done. In some other extant cases, you see, I was privy to the fact that at a point in time, I remember that at a time in Nigerian history, there was a snake president called Chuba Okadibo. Okadibo was removed from office by Obasanjo because he lobbied the National Assembly for him to be removed. I was at that particular point in time, I knew that the kind of money that was moving about in the National Assembly. At the time the police invaded his residence in the morning, I was the first person as a reporter. Somebody came to knock on my door. That was the person who became the deputy state president. If I can mention his name, Mantu. Mantu came to my house and said, well, what are you doing here? If you go to the Apo quarters, the police are surrounding the house of the Senate president. And when there, I saw police with armored vehicle everywhere. They had surrounded the house of Senate President Ocho Okadibo. Now, before then, we were getting the story and we saw the evidence that money moved. Money moved about members of the National Assembly, Senate in particular, to remove Okadibo. And they did it, they actualized it because of
that. Let me comment in that area. Let me comment. One thing that I have seen during that era that you are talking about is this. You see, there are some businessmen around the government. Are you getting me? Businessmen who are benefiting from that government, that does not want that government to leave office before their tenure ends or whatever they wanted. They are mostly the sponsor of all these things because they are benefiting from the government. That's the job of sycophants. They can do it without the knowledge.
Honorable, let's return to what we're discussing. What will be the impact of this loan? Should the us trading between the presidency and the legislature pull through?
Then
they both agree.
Then we are heading for another slavery.
How do you mean?
We are heading for another slavery. Slavery in the sense that, you know, such funds will not come ordinarily. To start with, I read in the news, as at yesterday, the IMF was already wrote to the president, to Nigerian president, to send them the blueprint of what they actually wanted to do with this fund. I don't know if you are aware. I read it on online news to send it. And afterwards,
of course, the last time IMF came to Nigeria, they were asking for, what do you need this loan
okay,
for?
Okay, fantastic. Then, you know, such loan doesn't come just ordinarily.
Absolutely.
It comes with conditionalities. Are you getting me? Conditionalities like increase your taxation. They will adjust your economic policy. Devalue your currency. Where we are today, do we need to devalue our currency the more? I tell you one thing. The basic salary in Nigeria, minimum wage,
18,
as it is called, 18,000. By the time you divide it with the current rate of exchange rate, it comes to how much? $40. If you use 450 naira to do the decimal, right? If you divide it with the pounds, it comes to 22 pounds
per month.
And I will tell you one thing. Tell me any product in Nigeria that does not have a dollar component. Mention one. Any product whatsoever, even if it is water, that does not have a dollar component. Gari also has. Pepe has.
How do you mean?
How do I mean? You see? You will know. Let me tell you one thing. Where is Gari? Where is it? Where is it planted? In the hinterland. Is that not so?
Mm-hmm.
Will you not transport the Gari out of that bush into the city to sell?
Mm-hmm.
So, the what about the transport? In cost of transporting it, the fuel, do you refine fuel in Nigeria? Even if you are refining fuel in Nigeria, at what rate are they selling it? The dollar rate that they are selling in the international market. That's what they're selling. So as the dollar rate is going up, so the transport system too is what is. Let me give you one instance. There was a day along my own constituency, along my, you know, my village. I was going to Abeokuta. I stopped by to buy a gari. As at the last time I bought before this administration, I bought it for 6,500 naira. A bag of 50 kilo. When I stopped by and said, "Mama, I want gari," Mama said, "Gari, Timon, it's not the usual price you are buying." I said, "Why? How much is it now?" I said, 15,000. I said, "Mama, are you all right?" I said, "Why?" Now she's all right now. I said, "Then what happened?" He said, "Dollar till us, okay. Dollar has gone up." I look at the woman. I say, "Mama, are you sure you don't need to go to our mental hospital?"
Mama, what has the dollar got to do? Gari.
She sat me down and educate me. Mama said, "Look at that pickup that is going. That the pickup has just come to drop cassava for them. And he has increased his transportation money. That the man told them that petrol has increased in price because dollar has what? Gone up." I've been sure you know petrol was 87 naira per liter before this administration came. And when the administration came, petrol becomes 145 naira. I'll be 147 naira, so to say. The woman further went down to say, "Look at this machine that we use in grinding the cassava to process the gari is using diesel. That they were buying the diesel for 130 before. Now diesel has gone to 210. Are you getting me? Not to talk of the machine itself that is not produced in Nigeria.
The parts
that is not produced in Nigeria. Are you getting me? I don't have any other option than to start begging the madam before he ended up accepting 12,000 naira.
For a bag of gari.
Are you not aware where when there was increase in the price of a tomato? It's all over the news that one tomato is being sold for maybe 100 naira or 200 naira. As against before. So all these things are affected by this currency we are talking about.
Now, that is just before this loan issue.
Now when the loan now comes, that's what I'm telling you. Which means we are going to be more impoverished. Because when you devalue the money again, you understand me? Then the monthly take home for an average worker now come to like five.
That is probably going to be one condition, devaluation of naira.
Yes.
We're not talking about increase in tax value.
If they increase, look, my dear brother,
the government is probably going to increase the VAT, that is what I'm saying,
that they will further impoverish the people. They will further impoverish the people.
The Senate holding to his guns on.
Well, I don't want to preempt them, but I will commend them for what they have done now. Because it may be a technical way of rejecting it. Are you getting me? It may be a technical way of if there is any underhand agreement or arrangement between the executive and the Senate, they will have it doesn't take them it doesn't take the Senate president to hit the gavel.
Yeah.
And so be it.
Chukwudi.
So be it.
Chukwudi.
Yes.
Where do we stand?
Let us believe, let us hope that common sense will prevail in the Senate. And in the country, because I don't think Nigeria needs this loan. We don't need this loan. Since the president came into office, he has been fighting assiduously to rescue Nigeria and to recover the money stolen by past administration, members of past administration. So I believe that if he goes further, even down to former governors who are still being prosecuted since they left office 8 years ago, and recover the loot they took away from Nigeria. They don't need to go to any bank, to any country to ask for loan. The money they will recover from them will be enough to kind of bring Nigeria back to where it's supposed to be.
My dear brother, let me quickly say this.
Okay.
I'll tell you one thing. By my own statistics, if we look inward and do what we need to do in Nigeria, I don't think we need any external loan. Because Nigeria is blessed, my brother. Nigeria is what? Is blessed. Like I said the other time, we can operate, Nigeria can go on autopilot. We can operate Nigeria on autopilot without anything, any money involved by the government. But because our leadership believe in giving our contract, and the contract we are talking about will be to their own benefit.
Back.
You understand me? We'll be to, and most of these jobs we are talking about are given to foreign contractors.
Right,
where they will fly the money alongside with their own overseas.
Yeah. Mm.
Tell me, all the money that are stacked all over the nation that we are reading in the news every day. I was made to understand, I saw something online that 90 billion naira was recovered from Desi Ani.
Yeah.
Either true or false, where is the money?
Where is the money?
All the money that has been said that have been recovered from all these mutas, where are the money? I'm aware that what the name of the prime minister here then, the former prime minister, said Nigeria is fantastically corrupt. Is that not so?
Mm-hmm.
We accept. Because once our presidency accepts, that means Nigerians has accepted. And all he said was that return the money. As £1 will return since then. The Abacha looked at even in Switzerland. Has it been returned fully?
Some have been returned.
Some have been returned, but with conditionalities. When they want to return this money, they will tell you, give us what you want to do with the money. Our own money, for that matter. And I tell you what, they are smarter. The little amount returned was the interest they generate on that money.
All right, gentlemen, we need to go on a very short break. When we return, we'll open the phone line for you to be part of the program. Do you think it's going to be in the best interest of Nigeria for the government of Nigeria under President Muhammadu Buhari to go for this $30 billion loan, bearing in mind that any loan coming from the World Bank or IMF doesn't come free of charge. It comes with very, very stringent conditions. When we come back, let's open the phone line and you'll be part of the program. Don't go away. We are still here on this podcast.
Network and increase your sales. Well, advertise your services with us here on Ben Television. Ben Television Sky 182. We are here to showcase you and promote you to our diverse viewers. Call us now on 0208 808 8800 or email us at bentelevisionuk@gmail.com. We are here to serve you.
Welcome to The Marketplace. The Marketplace is here to promote your business products and services and all your upcoming events. The Marketplace, now showing on Ben TV Sky 182 every Saturday at 10 a.m. and Sundays at 3 p.m. Do call us on 0743-890-9022. Or 0748-231-2105 and like us on Facebook, The Marketplace. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram. The Marketplace, here to showcase you to the world, to reach a wider audience. So don't delay. Your customers are waiting.
UDCI team, in conjunction with Ben Television Management and 805 Restaurant London, invites you to the first of its meet and greet series for our community. Join the team of the most talked about television program, UDCI, as we answer questions on political and social issues affecting our community both here in the diaspora and in Nigeria, 4th of December, 6 p.m. The venue is 805 Old Kent Road, London, South East 15, 1NX. See you there.
And still on his punch here on Ben Television, we're taking a look at the $30 billion loan request by the presidency of the Federal Republic, President Muhammadu Buhari. And my guest in the studio have been talking about the chances of the loan adding or not adding to Nigeria's economy in terms of positive or negative implication. And of course, from experience, we have known that international loans, either from IMF, World Bank, they come with conditions. Some of these conditions may include structural adjustment program in the economy, structural adjustment program in trade and investment, structural adjustment program in every angle. Let's open the phone line. Join us on the program. The number to call is 020-8808-0693 to be part of the program. Let me return. Honorable, so as it stands, 1.5 years of this administration, what do you say is the key thing successive governments have always had, Yar'Adua had,
seven-point agenda. Okay.
Jonathan came hard, 5 3-point agenda.
What's the agenda?
What do you think this government has as agenda to pursue?
Let me tell you what we've been hearing where the campaign was going on is that I will kill corruption because corruption what?
Kill Nigeria.
I will develop the economy, then fight Boko Haram. These are the three things. Whether it's written or not, I don't know. But there was no detailed explanation as to how the corruption will be killed then, or how the economy will be developed, or how Boko Haram will be what? Put to an end. I'm aware there was a time there was a debate, they organized a debate within the presidential aspirant, but PMB did not show up. That's what I know. But one thing I believe is this. Even I as a person, from my own little experience when I was contesting for the primaries of the governorship of Ogun State, I have my blueprint handy. And I don't know, maybe because I'm not part of APC, but I've never once seen or come across anything like a blueprint attached to what they wanted to do. And this is somebody that has been contesting election in the past 16 years. Are you with me? That is one. Two, for me, I would say the achievement of this government for now is got to do with corrupt fight. And maybe in area of trying to Boko Haram. Those are the two things I see. But in area of economy, I'm sorry with all due respect, as per my own thinking, it's woeful. You understand me? But on the issue of area of corruption, honestly, I would support Mr. President to anywhere over that. Even the judges that were accused of corruption, I supported it because I knew what the judges in Nigeria have been doing lately. You understand me? I have said it that one time ago in the parliament, I have amended the EFCC Act to a capital punishment because, but there was no single supporter to join me in that cause. Are you with me? So I will support. But you see, I want to appeal to this government. You see, the issue of this economy affects even the downtrodden. You see, you must separate corruption fight away from economic development. I tell you what, during the Obasanjo era, Obasanjo came, fought corruption also to a standstill, as at then, and at the same time, he was developing the economy. As at when he was coming, within that short period, he has his blueprint prepared. As he was getting to the office, he knew we had problem in area of economy. We had problem with foreign issues. Our image in foreign country is what? Is bad. Corruption has ravaged the system. Obasanjo came in, met a pantry sum of less than 4 billion in the foreign cover, with over 60 billion debt. And as soon as he came to the office, he swung into action. First and foremost, send a bill to the parliament to enact EFCC and ICPC to fight corruption. Secondly, he sent another bill to the parliament on privatization and commercialization, saying government has no business in doing business. And from there, he realized that our economy is in a bad shape. How do we do it? How do we manage the economy? The man went to World Bank to seek from Nigerians that are working there to come and help them back home. He was giving Okonjo-Iweala Dr. Nkosi Okonjo-Iweala, is that not so? And at whom he made the Minister for Finance. He was given Professor Charles Soludo. He made him the Special Advisor on Economy Matters, who later became the CBN Governor. He knew our image in the international community was bad. I have seen the situation in Chicago Airport, where it was written "Beware of Nigeria" sticker on the wall at the airport. I saw it. As I then, when you have a Nigerian passport, without committing any crime, when you are even going to face immigration, you are always scared. Because they will tell you, the moment they saw the green passport, they will tell you to stand
Don't
stand
can aside. I just no, one no. minute, just no, one minute.
They ask you to stand aside. Are you getting me? Now, the man went to, in order to clear that, he went to United Nations and said, give me the Nigerian there to come and help me on the issue of foreign affairs. They gave him Ambassador Adeniji, whom eventually make the Minister for Foreign Affairs.
All right, let me
and through Adeniji, they went around, got their relief for Nigeria, though they paid part of the money, and not only Nigeria then, that's what Nigerians don't know.
So you're talking about the time Obasanjo came, he knew Nigeria's problem, and had
no principle. You understand me? That's what I'm expecting of this government to do as well.
But
I tell you, I have not spoken since they started, because I need to give them time.
Let me put it on hold. I've got Don. Don, thank you for joining us, and thank you for holding on. Go ahead, Don.
Yeah, I just want to make a contribution on this issue of taking out loan
gone
with the international community. I just want to observe that when I was in the university in Nigeria, the loan IMF loan came up, and many people criticized it, many people argued against it, but Nigeria went ahead to take the loan. I know what we suffered up till the period that we were able to resolve to settle that bill. Now we are about to start up about development again, and another loan is now in the pipeline. If you, my own observation is that if this loan goes on, then that will destroy Nigeria for a long time. And that I feel that Nigerians should learn a lesson from what happened during the IMF loan, and try and survive. All this cutting down on expenditures is not just in Nigeria, it's everywhere. So why must Nigeria go into borrowing when every other person is trying to cut down on their costs? So Nigeria should look around the world that they are not still alone.
Thank you so much, Don. Thank you for that flashback and that recommendation. Thank you, Don. Thank you for that. Chukwudi, you heard Honorable about you're coming to power, you understand the problem of the nation, and you have a solution. Would you say this government has attacked Nigeria's problems
headlong
from a man who has been trying to become president for the last 16 years? Would you say that's a kind of a blueprint to deal with Nigeria's crisis?
Well, thank you so much.
From how Obasanjo, from his analysis of Obasanjo, dealt with Nigeria's problem.
From what he has said, and we all of us have been witness what Obasanjo did in power when he came in. On that first day, he started walking. Unfortunately, it's not the same thing with President Buhari. It seemed that he had no blueprints. He wanted to get power then before thinking of what to do. And that was why I blame Nigerians for allowing him to stay 3 months before saying, I want to make appointments after 3 months. That was slowing down the wheel of government governance, and it wasn't supposed to be like that. So it appeared that he was not prepared for governance. He was just prepared to capture power. Once you capture power, then begin to know what you want to do with power.
Mm-mm.
We remember very vividly some years back that Chief Abofim Awolowo said that if he cannot leave Nigeria for 24 hours, that's a man who was prepared. So Buhari ought to be prepared to rule Nigeria. We have a blueprint on every area, on every facet of life, on every institution in Nigeria. Must have a blueprint how to implement, how to run from day one. He didn't have it. So that is why Nigeria.
It does appear that he did not. We cannot say it didn't.
No, it does appear he doesn't have it. He didn't. In fact, it doesn't.
Where is it?
We have not seen it.
Have you seen it?
I'm a supporter of Buhari, but from what is on the ground, he doesn't have it.
No clue.
If you have it, you will know those to appoint in every particular position. You will have people. If I put me there today, I know who to give a minister of finance minister.
Absolutely.
I know who to make agricultural minister. I'm nowhere now, but if I tell you I can do that. So somebody who has been there for more than 16 years, trying to acquire power, capture power, you ought to have a fallback position.
Everything.
Okay, all right. Anger, Mr. Anger, Anger from London. Good evening.
London.
From Kent. Do I get your name right, Anger?
Yeah.
All right, thanks so much. Go ahead and make your point. Go ahead.
Yeah, like the last last caller rightly said, loan has been a problem to us. Are you on now?
Yes, go on. You're live. Go on. Turn down the volume of your TV set.
Like the last speaker has said, or caller, loan has been a problem to Nigeria. But most time the loan we take, we don't use it. And I believe that taking a loan at this time will not benefit Nigeria. Rather, they should try to do any adjustment. First of all, a lot of money has been said to have been recovered from past politicians. What are those money? Secondly, instead of taking loan, the electorate should make sacrifice. So much money goes into senators and House of Rep members. They should slide their salary. They should make sacrifice for Nigeria to settle whatever problem we have at this time. And if they actually love Nigeria, they should be able to make some sacrifice at this time around. In fact, Mr. President, yeah, he's doing something, but for me, I haven't seen the head wave which is going on. Because I expected that before he's sworn in, he's supposed to have laid out what he will intend to do. How he want to fight the corruption like Adiaraman.
All right, okay, sure. Anger, I'm afraid I need to stop you here now.
Right now, things are not moving straight forward.
All right, okay, Anger, thank you. Anger, thank you so much. Thank you so much for your contribution. I'm afraid, gentlemen. I'm afraid I haven't got the time.
God.
I haven't got the time.
Give us some little time to
you're looking for a solution. In 1 minute, what is the way out? In 1 minute, just 1 minute.
Let me tell you the way out. We need to cut down our expenses. Look, there are some materials or goods that we don't need in, especially the 41 item banned halfway by this government. You remember that they said they should not assess foreign exchange from any bank, that they should go to the black market. You remember?
Yeah.
Those items should be completely banned. Because by the time you ask them to go and access money at the black market, there will be pressure on Naira. Therefore, demand for dollar will be more. And that shot up, that is one. Two, our petroleum product, I'm talking about the crude, that God-given product that we have, most of the Western countries, West African coast, they have refinery. We are spending over and above 50%, half of our foreign revenue, importing fuel. Why we can set up modular refineries around to save such money? Though I'm aware Dangote is doing one, but when will it take off? I'm aware some people are doing this thing locally in Niger Delta, that the government will not allow it. They said they were doing adulterated. If not adulterated...
Oh. I'm afraid, Honorable Sir.
Well, I think you need to give us more time
to digest all this thing. We'll consider this program coming back.
There are still accusations to reduce unemployment and do all sorts of things.
Chukwudi, thank you so much for being part of the program. Chukwudi is the chairman of the Arsenal Nigerian journalist in the United Kingdom. Thank you for joining us on the program today. Honorable Claudia Musson, former member House of Representatives and former gubernatorial aspirant Ogun State 2015. Thank you for joining us on the program
today. You're welcome.
Nigeria's problem is so many that we can't finish talking about it, even in 1 year.
Honestly.
All right, my name is Tunde Alabi. It's a pleasure having you all you guys join us on the program today. I need to call the show now. Enjoy the rest of your night. Bye.
On 0208-808-8800 or email us at bentelevisionuk@gmail.com. We are here to serve you.
You decide team in conjunction with